The underscore in Python has many different uses. In this tutorial, we take a look at 6 different examples of where the underscore character is utilized in the Python programming language. Hello, my name is Xander and welcome to Very Academy. Hopefully by the end of this tutorial, you will be able to recognize the different applications of the underscore character used within the Python programming language. Just before we start, just want to say a big thank you to all the current members of this channel. If you would like to follow us further or support us further, then please consider becoming a channel member or follow us on Patreon. And don't forget to like and subscribe if you would like to get involved in the community. You can find us on many of the socials. So let's start off by looking at the single underscore. The single underscore is a valid Python identifier. Therefore, we can utilize it to create a variable. So underscore equals ABC, and then we can utilize that or call that to return the value from the variable. Now, Python utilizes it as such, and the underscore name actually points or is used as the last expression in the interactive interpreter. Let's go ahead and open up a new Python shell, interactive session, and perform a simple calculation. So 1 plus 1. Behind the scenes here, the last expression is stored in the interpreter, and the underscore is utilized as the identifier to access that last expression. So we can utilize the underscore here, and it returns 2. So that might not actually be very interesting, but when you consider the next point here, it has some relevance. There are many different conventions in programming languages, and this helps. One of the reasons for conventions is it helps other people read and understand your code. So the underscore can be utilized, like we saw previously there, it can be used to represent a value that we don't really care about, or it won't be utilized later in our program. A throwaway name, if you like. So now it makes a little bit more sense why the last expression in the interpreter utilizes the underscore as the Python identifier for calling the last expression in the interpreter. This type of convention helps other people read your code. So for example, if we had a variable name here equals something, then that has great relevance. We know that this variable is going to store a name, and potentially we might want to use it somewhere else in our code. It's very easy to understand. Name, obviously in the context of this program, that may make sense. So by using underscore here, essentially we're going to create some sort of variable utilizing this identifier here. And it's saying to the reader that this has no real relevance. It's kind of a throwaway thing that we don't need to worry about or think about. Take, for example, this example when we create a simple loop, so a for loop. So we can use the underscore here because it doesn't matter, and then have some sort of range maybe, and then we go ahead and just print out something. So notice in this instance, we're not actually calling this at all. We're not utilizing this. We're just printing out hello. The idea of this piece of code is just to loop around twice and print hello. And the underscore here of this value, this name, has no relevance. Therefore, we use the underscore. Because we cover a lot of Django on this channel, it's also worth mentioning the underscore being utilized as a function. You often see the underscore utilized for internationalization and localization, string translation lookups. This is an example of an extract from maybe a Django application. So for example, here we get text as underscore, and then we identify the text that requires translating. So this is a type of convention that's utilized that you might see in a Django application. And it essentially just identifies that requires translation. So it would be worth noting that if you are using this underscore in Django, for example, as a convention to identify what needs translations, then it might be wise not to then utilize the underscore in the code block for other means. So, for example, in the previous example, where we utilized it as a way of identifying a throwaway name. So next up, the leading or prefixed underscore. Unlike other programming languages such as Java, Python doesn't have a strong distinction between private and public variables. A leading underscore or single underscore before a name is used to specify that the name is to be treated as private by the programmer. This convention adds readability to your code. The next developer reading your code can understand the fact that that particular variable, for example, is meant to be private or is a non-public part of an API. And that can be a variable or it could be a function. Although I've described the single underscore before a name as a convention, it does have an effect on your code. So here you can see that we have a name here. A variable name with an underscore prefix defining the fact this is a private variable. And then we have the same kind of situation here with the function. So we've utilized the underscore prefix before the name of the function. And this does have an effect in your code. So if we go over to, we've got A and B here. So we go over to B here. Let's try and import the resources from A. So import A. From A, import all. So let's import everything into here, like you might do within your code. And let's just go and see if we can then actually access this information. So here we have the external function, which should return 100. So we give that a go. So that should be accessible via the import. So if we go ahead and try and run that, you can see it returns the expected amount. And let's just try now and utilize the internal. So this has been flagged as private, so it shouldn't be importable. So let's give that a go. And we should receive an error. And there we go. There's a little bit more there to learn in regards to the single underscore before the name. But that's something as you start to develop your understanding on object-oriented programming, if you haven't done so, and this being a very much kind of beginner's guide. So that's something to consider and maybe read more about. So next up then, let's talk a little bit about this single trailing underscore. And this is fairly simple to understand, and it is defined in PEP. If you're new to Python, it's definitely worth looking over the PEP 8 style guidelines for Python, and it'll give you a general overview how to lay out, present your code and general conventions when using the language. So if you read through eventually down here, you're going to find some information about the trailing underscore. And it tells us that the trailing underscore here is used as a convention to avoid conflicts with Python keywords. So again, if you haven't come across the Python keywords, it's well worth having a look at that. So import keyword, print keyword list, give that a go, and that will then return some of the different keywords that have been defined by Python as something that is utilized within the language here. So if, for example, you wanted to utilize one of these keywords, maybe for a variable, then potentially utilizing an underscore at the end of that to avoid crossover here of utilizing one of these keywords that have been defined within the language. So let's now move on to the double underscore. So the double underscore before the name or before the identifier. The double before has a very interesting effect. The Python interpreter will perform name mangling to any identifier or name with leading underscores. So this takes us into the world of object-oriented programming. This example here, you can see that we have this method and we're utilizing the double underscore before the name or the identifier. And this is going to help avoid conflicts of names between the current class and maybe any of the subclasses, which isn't shown here, but let me just show you the example. So here we have a class called person. We have an external function, an internal function, just by name, that's all. But you can see here that the internal function has the prefix of a double underscore. So let's just go ahead and use dir, which is going to list out all the functions that are inside of this class here. So we just run this, and you can see that what we have here, we've named the function. So this name here, function, you can see it's named here, and this gives us an idea of what functions or methods are inside of this class. But notice here that the internal function here, which has the double underscore prefix, that's been named differently. So this is the process of name mangling. So we can say that this method here has been mangled to the class name and underscore, underscore, and then the name. So only as a bad example, we go ahead and create a subclass here and we inherit from person. And maybe this subclass has a similar name, internal function. And you can see we go ahead and use the double underscore prefix there so that Python performs mangling on this. And then we go ahead and we can print this subclass. And we can see from this that we still have access to the initial function, which has a similar name to the subclass. And we also have the new internal function subclass item, which might perform a completely different task. So just keeping things nice and light, it is worth noting that there is some further reading here with the leading double underscores. There's some interesting behaviors when utilizing that in object-oriented programming. Okay, so notice that there isn't any trailing double underscore, so there's no use for that in Python. So let's move across now to the double underscore. Now this, if you have used Python for a little while, you probably already utilized the double doubles, the leading and trailing double underscores. Now the double leading and trailing underscore has, or is probably the most important pattern in Python. The double leading and trailing underscores are reserved for special use in Python, and generally they're called magic names. But they can also be known as Dunder methods. So if you have used Python, you've probably already seen these type of Dunder methods utilized in object-oriented programming. This is a simple example here where we have the init Dunder method and the string Dunder method here, or magic method, and you can see that this is going to initialize these values, and then we use the default string here, which is then going to be utilized to return. So here we have print person 22, so we take in 22 if you're not familiar with object-oriented programming, and you can see that we're going to initialize these values here, store them when we create the class, and then we're going to use the string Dunder method here, this magic method, and that's going to automatically just return, or we're going to define what gets returned when we call this class. So what gets returned here, as you can already see, person has feet and hands. If, for example, we remove this Dunder method here, you can see that we don't return anything by default. So you can see here that this is a special magic method which we can override, and then we can have some sort of default return on the class. Needless to say, there are many of these Dunder or magic methods in Python, and it's well worth reading through them. So let's just finish off with the single underscore for numeric literals. So here we can use the underscore as a visual separator for digit grouping. So this is defined, I think, in the PEP 515, or stated in PEP 515, so it's well worth having a little read of that. But let's just quickly see an example. So in terms of readability of your code, it can maybe be difficult to quickly identify the number if it's displayed like this. So we can utilize the underscore to basically just break up the number. Python works with the number exactly the same, but it's just a way of us visually separating digits to make it easier for us to work with. So this is going to work for integers, floating points, and complex number literals. So it's definitely something you can introduce into your code without any problems. So if we go ahead and just print this out, it's not going to print out the underscores. Again, it's just a convention, a way of grouping numbers so we can visually see the numbers, make it easier to identify the number. So hopefully at this point, it gives you a general overview of how underscores are utilized in Python. If you are moving into and you haven't done that object-oriented programming, it's well worth reading through double underscore before, the leading underscore double underscores, and also to read a little bit more about the Dunder methods. Hopefully that was some value to you. Hopefully you got this far. If you have got this far, thank you very much for listening, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.